Yeah, in this last video of this lecture, I want to give you a brief teaser of PyTorch convenience functions, the linear or fully connected layer, but also like to just wrap up the conventions regarding linear algebra. So, what do I mean by fully connected or linear layer? So if we have a multi-layer network, like shown here, so this part here would be a linear transformation if we don't consider the activation function. And you can also think of this as a fully connected layer. So this is sometimes called fully connected layer. Or sometimes people also call that a dense layer. In PyTorch, it's called a linear layer because it's a linear transformation. So you can also think of it as a linear layer. And in the context of Keras and TensorFlow, people call it a dense layer. So all these things are equivalent. So another dense layer or fully connected layer would be from here to here. So neural network really is a concatenation of multiple of these fully connected layers, which are then interspersed with these nonlinear activation functions, for example. So you can do this many, many times. But also, multi-layer networks are a topic for a different time, for a different lecture next week, just outlining already how that relates to linear algebra here. So how we then implement a fully connected layer in PyTorch is very simple. There's actually a function called torchnn.linear. So let's start with the data set here. So let's assume I'm just creating some random data, but let's assume this is some valid training data. So this is an design matrix with dimensionality, 10 times 5. 10 times 5 input matrix. And then when we initialize this linear layer, we give it the number of features, and the number, so that's the input features, and the number of output features. So here we have 5 features, like that's our design matrix, the n times m matrix. And let's say we want 3 output features. The output features, if I go back one slide, are these here, what I highlighted. Here you can think of it as these here, the net inputs. So that's basically the number of outputs, and they are computed via this linear transformation. All right, so then each of these linear layers, when you initialize it here, has attached as an attribute a weight matrix and a bias vector. So the weight matrix, you can see it here, is h times m, or in this case 3 times 5 dimensional, right? So you have 3 rows and 5 columns, so 3 by 5 dimensional. So you can see that this 5 here matches with this 5. So that's the number of input features. And the bias unit is equal to the number of output features. So in this case, it's a vector with 3 values. So because each output has a bias unit attached to it. So here we would have 5 inputs in the next slide example, if I would modify it here, and 3 outputs. All right, so, and notice here, these are also small random values. We will talk about it later, why it's useful to have random values here instead of all zeros. Now, here I'm printing the dimensions for the input, the weight, and the bias. So it's 10 by 5, 3 by 5, and 3. Now I'm applying this fully connected layer. So I'm applying it to this x, which is 10 times 5. And the w, which is 3 times 5, and the output, so there is also plus b, so this is a matrix multiplication, plus b, which is 3 dimensional, and the output is, what is it, 10 times 3 dimensional. A is a 10 times 3 dimensional matrix. So how does that work? So what is going on here? So you can already probably see there must be some transpose here for the w, right? So that the 5 goes in front, the 3 goes here, and then maybe it's compatible with this x, but is it really what's going on? So yeah, that's what's going on. So here I have a summary of that. So I also have to stare for it, I have to stare at it for a few seconds. Let me see what I've written down here. So yeah, based on PyTorch, we have another convention here. Recall in the last video, I mentioned the convention where the W, the transformation matrix or weight matrix, is in front of X. In PyTorch, it's after X. And I think this makes sense, not from a geometry perspective, but from a data flow perspective, because in this way we have to use fewer transposes. And also it's kind of symbolizing the way the data flows through the network. So we start with X, and then we multiply it by a weight matrix W, and then we get A. So we have X dot W resulting in A and stuff like that. So it's more like this linear flow here. Actually, I'm writing always A, but it's the net input, so depends on whether we apply the activation function or not. I have it here. No worries then. All right, so if we have an input with one training example, like this X here, this vector, then we can use the notation where X is in front. If we transpose W, then the dimensions will match, right? So here in this case, it's a 1 times M dimensional vector, where W is an M times H dimensional vector. So the result, W will be just one value. The result will be then a 1 times H dimensional vector. And if we have N inputs, then we can also keep X in front. We can also transpose W then. In this case, what will happen is that we have an N times M dimensional one here. Here the same M times H dimensional one, and here we will have an N times H dimensional one. So this way, what is nice about this convention is we can keep the same operations here, whether this is multiple or only one data point. So this is actually quite convenient from a computational perspective. So if we have code, we don't have to change much around. And if you don't believe me that this is the way PyTorch does it, here is the source code if you want to look at it. So this is like the common convention in PyTorch, how the linear transformation happens. So just to conclude, there are multiple different ways we can compute this linear transformation. What's really important is thinking about it. Like, always think about how the dot products are computed when writing and implementing matrix multiplication. So because sometimes it's easy to make mistakes. So things may compute because dimensions match, but it's not computing what you wanted it to compute. So it's always important to write down what the dimensions are and what you're computing and what you expect the output is. Also theoretical intuition and convention, like having the W in front as the transformation matrix, does not always match up with practical convenience, like when we write things in code. So here I've written down some rules that you might find useful when you're reading textbooks, and things are not the same as, let's say, in code. So you can easily translate between those concepts. For example, if you have two matrices A and B, multiplying those is the same as B transpose A transpose and then taking the outer transpose here. So that's the same thing. And also here, these are the same. So I was just writing down some rules here that help you maybe navigating switches between code and textbooks. I think you probably won't read many textbooks because there are not many deep learning textbooks really yet, but maybe in the future sometime. But also in papers, people use all kinds of different conventions. So I think this is like a handy thing to keep in mind. And also just to summarize traditional versus PyTorch conventions. So there are multiple ways we can compute this linear transformation. Like I mentioned, we can have this weight matrix up front. So this would result then in H times one dimensional vector when X is a feature vector M times one dimensional. This is the same using the rule that I showed you in the previous slide as writing it like this. Same thing. So it gives us we have the same input, gives us the same output. Another way we can write that is how PyTorch does that, is putting the X in front. But we are transposing W here. This gives a, or this assumes a different input though. This assumes the 1 times m dimensional input. And yeah, this is actually my preferred representation, because this is kind of easy when we go back and forth between one or multiple training examples, because now here at the bottom would be the cases where we have n training examples. So if we want to use it the traditional way, we have to use true transposes, which is more work. So this is the usual case in deep learning. We have usually many inputs and many outputs, so we only have to use one transpose. It's shorter, and this is also the way PyTorch implements it. So this is also the PyTorch convention. So just to sum it up for this lecture. So yeah, as a little ungraded homework experiment, you may, yeah, you can, if you have extra time, revisit the perceptron NumPy code. And without even running the code, just thinking about it, can you tell if the perceptron could predict the class labels if we feed it an array? I'm actually underlining it in an unfortunate way. Without running the code, can you tell if the perceptron could predict the class labels if we feed an array of multiple training examples at once? So if we have a design matrix of dimensionality n times m for testing, would it be able to run after training? So if yes, why? If not, what change to the code do you have to make? So you can think of this a little bit, and then you can actually run the code, right, with the design matrix as input for prediction, and see whether your intuition was correct. And also feel free to open a discussion on Piazza about that. So yeah, run and verify your intuition. And then how about the train method? Can we also have some parallelism through matrix multiplications in the train method, having multiple training examples? So does it make sense without, let's say, fundamentally changing the perceptron learning rule? Would that make sense? So it's also another thing to think about. All right, so next lecture then we will talk about more like a deep learning topic that is not like fundamental linear algebra. We will talk about a better learning algorithm for neural networks. So we learned about the perceptron rule last week, but this is actually not a very good learning rule, and we will develop a better learning rule next lecture.